good. Fred, I'm sure your wife is there.
Second floor, hardware, children's wear, ladies' lingerie. Oh, good morning, Mr. Tyler. Going down?
That's it. Hold on, hold on. That's the place. Two. So goes loving and then loving and then. Da 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 da, but I'm going now. Loving and then loving, keep it smooth right to the end. Da 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 da, and I'm down, down, down. Yeah. So you see what's going on there? What? You gotta bring us into that, but the band's gonna stay straight, and you're gonna go rat da da ga ga. You can't hear me? Hey, can you get Joey? Turn Joey's cans on, put my vocal in Joey's cans.
Okay, I got you.
You got me now? Okay, we're gonna go 2, 2, 3, 4. Loving an elevator. This is right before the guitar solo. Loving an elevator. Living it up.
I am responsible for the title Pump. It's my fault. It truly is an epic, the whole tale of the title. I came up with the title shortly after our permanent vacation tour had ended. We were having a business meeting, and as usual, I was daydreaming. And was looking around at all the titles of our previous albums, which adorn our manager's office. And I'm going, oh, we gotta do another one of these now. Another album, another title. And that's really where Pump originated at that meeting, because I thought the Aerosmith logo reminded me of the old Flying A gasoline sign. And I started to go with the whole gasoline station theme. And I started working with that. I started working with one of the guys at the office, Keith Gard. I told him about my idea, and we said, yeah, Pump, just, is it Pumps? Is it, And it just became Pump, and we thought it was great, and everybody thought it was great, except the guys in my band.
Well, that's the thing. You know, if this was our first record, it would be, you'd never put Fine on the record, but it being Aerosmith, people are going to go, Fine, what did they call it that for, you know?
And then someone would say, because it's fucked up, insecure, neurotic, and emotional, that's what it stands for, and everybody will go, oh, now I know why they did that.
I mean, it's a chance, that's all. You know, I mean, it's our 14th record, and everything else has been like a really literal, cool rock and roll title. If it was a weak album, it would be one thing, but the album's really strong, you know? So it really doesn't matter what we call it, so why not have some fun with it?
Well, I don't like it. Fine at all. I don't want a record called Fine. That's how, you know.
All right.
What's your record called?
Yeah, but what's your record called, Pump? What the fuck is that?
The names, I mean, I have a list that somewhere in my files, I think there's over 100 titles on it, and people were going crazy. Everybody wants to name the record. It becomes this kind of a challenge.
Okay, back to the drawing boards then.
Because I get the same reaction about Pump.
Oh, do you?
Yeah.
As a title?
Aaron. See, they don't think about it completely about sex, as older folks.
It's
immediately
nice
our minds. My mother couldn't even say it.
Looking up your old address?
No, Pump.
Pump.
She couldn't even say it. She got embarrassed. I mean, when I told her that, what the title was with the kids, they think about being pumped up when they hear it. You know, they don't, like, associate it with sex right off.
Yeah.
So it's like, it works better for them, I think. That's like saying fuck to an older person.
When Brad first thought of it, you know, the idea, where it came from, I thought it was great. I said, okay, fine, that's good, you know. And then you hear stuff from other people, and they, no, we don't like it. No, that won't, yes, no. Oh, because of this, and no, it's too hokey, and then and on and on. And then you start listening to them, and every time we decide something, we go off and we talk to different people, and it would screw us all up.
There was a survey done by the accounting firm of, Brian and David did a little survey. They asked people five names here. Elevator, Fine, Here's Looking Up Your Old Address, Monkey House, and Pump.
And the survey went from Vancouver to Revere to Southborough.
People were just scraping the bottom of their shoes looking for, you know, inspected by, I mean, anything that came into your head. But Pump did win out, and I just thought it was such a good title because it said so many things. It was sexual, it was musical, it was 90s, you know.
It's more about the dynamics of the band, that process. It's not even about the title of the album anymore. It's about, you know, who's right and who isn't, you know, who can make the best argument or be the best politician. It's kind of fun, actually, because it takes pressure off the songs, you know. Process that we go through, we still have to sell ourselves to the record company, and believe it or not, we actually got up to the studio, and I don't think they were convinced we had the material.
All right, well, let's do the next one here.
Thank you. got this balance going on, where you've got the band pretty much just wanting to do what they like, what they feel, and what makes them feel good. But you've got people that come in from your record company. For instance, in our case, John Kolodner. He's our main contact and our mentor at our record company. And he loves our music. And along with just having a love of the music and enthusiasm for what we're doing, his mind is also thinking, which of these songs do I hear that might get on the radio or that a lot of other people might like to listen to as well. And so he's got to develop a sense of that and encourage the band in certain directions.
To me, that's a real great live tune, real nasty, and Steven just gets out and, you know, rips it out. Good, you know, kind of attitude.
It would be nice if it had some kind of guitar or other hook in it musically, which it doesn't have yet, but you'll have to see how that goes as you're making it.
Yeah.
More than anything, you want to please John Kolodner because, I mean, he's right there with you, really, and he knows what we're capable of. So he's just pushing and pushing and pushing because, you know, we might get lazy, we might be, you know, our focus can be off. And so John's just going, I know you guys can do better than this, or, you know, it's got to be this way. And you're going, oh, geez, can't we go drive our cars now?
You really should put a chorus in after the first verse.
Oh, I see.
Because that really works, and it doesn't disturb. I mean, I am pleased because it is a compromise between what they want and I want, because it doesn't interfere with the rest of the song.
Yeah.
But it needs it because it's going too long before that chorus.
We're always complaining that there isn't enough of it done, and how can he make a judgment on a song that doesn't have all the lyrics? And yeah, but we don't have the lyrics. Well, we've got to play it for him anyway. So all that stuff, it's all part of the process, and a lot of it's hard.
And even Joe Parisolo, is that a Parisolo?
Yeah.
I mean, that's going in the right direction.
Oh, that's great.
I'm surprised how good that is.
Yeah, the sound on that solo is something you've never heard before.
Which is what this whole album, I mean, already there's a couple songs that don't sound like anything else. I mean, this song doesn't sound like anything that's ever been recorded, which is why I think it's going to get so much attention.
It's real simple. For me now, looking back in retrospect on the whole procedure of creativity, quite often, we who are creating at the time, it's like a painting, and you get stuck by being the painter, by being in the frame, when in reality, the people that buy it and love the painting are standing back a little from it, right? So we being the creators, creative people, are like stuck in the frame and can't see that the colors, the reds are kind of fusing. We like to think it is, because hey, I know everything, I'm the greatest, right? So, but in that process of creativity, which by the way, there's a lot of lunacy, and not just because the moon is full, it takes somebody like Kolodner, or whoever the designated bad guy is, to come in and say, hey, no, man, you should, you know, if you don't mind me saying so, you should try that. And John Kolodner's never said anything more than that. You know, I don't like that, you should try doing this there. And it's not finished until you change that lyric. And he'll be to the point, but he says it with love. You know, he knows that we have the bottom line, and he never lets us think any different, which is real good for us. It makes me want him to be even more critical.